Cliff Phillips and I are standing here in front of the Alexandria Highway 61, I guess. Is it coming out of
it's east entrance.
Okay. Cliff Phillips, you're a pastor of the community church there, the Payson Avenue Community Church in Quincy. Mm-hmm. And your congregation is not a large one. What is your the number of your congregation?
We run in the 40s and 50s.
40s and 50s.
Right.
And of course, you're kind of new in that area. What, last year or two or 2 years?
Three years.
Time goes fast, doesn't it?
It does.
You're going to be working with several pastors in the future here to try to help put homes back together. And our mission right here is to let people see the devastation that's going on in small towns that are in the area. One is Alexandria, population 417. You mentioned a while ago that there's a rule being passed down. They're thinking about 50%. What did that mean?
The Corps of Engineers has a rule that says if a property is damaged more than 50%
of the value
in a floodplain area, it cannot be rebuilt. And I've just had the sad experience of spending about 45 minutes over there talking to people while you and Jim were
fixing the camera.
And Carl, I have to say my heart's heavy. I've talked to some of the citizens there, and they're very anxious about that rule because there isn't a house in town that's not damaged more than 50%.
We talked to one owner just a moment ago, and he has a nicer house.
He had a swimming pool and a beautiful home. It's damaged far more than 50%. We'll be visiting with one of the officials of the city in a little bit, Denise. She has a house trailer in there that's damaged more than that. Her folks have a home in there that's off the foundation. And so there's a serious question being brought up here, and the townspeople are very distressed about it, because if that rule applies here, chances are it'll apply in Niote and in Meyer and in Hull as well.
It'll have to by law.
And so unless there's some break given or some allowance given, this is really a sad situation.
Right. But
my heart's heavy, not only because of the physical destruction that we've seen, but as you talk to these people, their hearts are heavy. They're, you know, some of them have lived here many, many years, and this is home.
Born and raised here.
Born and raised here, and this home.
What we're going to do right now, for the benefit of all our audience here, is give you a lot of footage of the houses that's been destroyed and the force. We're standing on top of the levee area where it broke. Now, Cliff, you said a while ago the lady said it broke just in this area, just north of town.
The levee broke right over here. When we get over into town, we'll see where the levee did break and the force that it brought as the water came through, as it moved buildings that we'll take a picture of after a bit. But I think, Carl, we ought to discuss just a little bit the purpose, because as these 20-25 churches come together, our purpose is to reach out in the name of Christ and give a helping hand. And if the church has ever in its history, in American history, had an opportunity to minister, it's now. And we can reach out in brotherly love and
concern. You're not talking only finances,
We're talking about coming out here and getting on the end of a shovel.
Amen.
And a hose and helping these people rebuild their lives.
Right.
And sharing with them the fact that in spite of what's happened to them,
yes,
God still loves them.
This can be turned into a blessing instead of a curse.
That's right.
It depends on the Church of the Living God. If we're really going to function as a body of Christ, let's do that and be no respecter of person. So let's go on now into Alexandria. You'll see a population of 417 and how their community has come under this great flood of 93. But we want to take this opportunity to let you see what's going on. You might be moved with compassion toward your fellow man. Praise the Lord.
Headquarters for Alexandria. This Texaco station up here is where the mayor's been holding forth since the flood.
Right.
And of course, this firework stand's a familiar landmark here. I don't know how familiar it's going to remain. It's totally good.
Okay, what's this white truck here, Brother Cliff?
The white truck's the Salvation Army, and the major from Keokuk is here. They have been here since the flood started. They took food over to the firehouse and the schoolhouse at Wayland, and they've been providing a marvelous service to these
We're going to drive on through here, aren't we?
We're going to drive on through here. And what we're seeing here is family members coming to see what happened to the homes of their family. There's some local citizens here. I hope this lady moves for us. We're going to go right down into the town and follow the flood into town. Now right here, Jim, I think you have footage of this where the dam broke over there.
Yes, Kate.
And this house trailer has been moved out into the road. There was another shop that's set right here in front of where these people are.
And it's setting on the right-hand side.
Over here on the right-hand side.
I'll take it turn down.
Okay, well, we'll try it. See how deep this water is here.
That's all right.
Loaded 100 yards
from back
right
in
here,
the trees.
Way back, and it's sitting here in the middle of the road, right here. It's irreparable. That home is lost now.
The house behind it here, the house itself is off its foundation. It's right here with major damage.
Right.
And we're going to talk
the one behind it. See that home back here? That's completely gone. This little home here, the porch, of course, the whole house is shifted down. Everything was underwater except about 2 foot of the roof for over 30 days. Is that right, Brother Cliff?
Yes, you're right. You can see the water line on these houses, this white one here especially. It's clear up to the eaves in front, and about a foot above that is
this,
the water line.
This house trailer is washed down here with the house right beside the road. Probably over 100 yards from where we were too, wasn't it? Yeah.
Well, it was a beautiful home right here. And you can see how the water bounced the porch off, floated it up and down until it...
Carl, can you move your glasses up there?
It's broken loose. As we talk about cleanup, it's going to be a while yet. Because
yes.
People are not going to be allowed to move back in here at all until after the dam. They can come in and clean up, but they're not likely to want to do that because 4 or 5 rains can put this water right back where it is now with the levees in the condition there.
And up north the other day, yesterday, they had 6-inch rain.
In Cedar Rapids yesterday. Here's a nice home. You can see the damage to the drug. In the house.
The inside the house is absolutely devastated.
Hopefully we're going to get in a house down here. I think they're following the people out here. We've
got a white picket. See the mud there, Jim? It fills the house and everything.
Yeah, let me get a shot of this here. Yeah, there's going to be a lot of work scraping it off all these roads, isn't there?
Yeah, same amount of mud inside the house.
Oh, the mud's on the floor of the house,
yes,
like that.
Now, someone's started to do some cleanup there at 228. You can see the mess that's thrown outside. They just opened the window and started it. But the task is overwhelming. And these people, as you talk to them, are heartbroken. They're confused about what the government's going to do or not going to do. They have provided, FEMA's provided temporary housing for some of these people, but it's for an 18-month period. They put them in house trailers, wherever they can get located. Looks like we get fairly deep here. We're going back to two churches that are back here.
Yeah, that truck in front of us there shows us how deep we are here, really.
Your brakes are going to be a little hard for a while, Carl, after running in this much water. This is the schoolhouse, and when we talked to Denise after a bit, she was back here working in this schoolhouse making sandwiches for the levee workers, and she had worked for 26 straight hours, and she was asleep on one of the tables when the levee broke, and they forgot to wake her. And so by the time someone thought of her, it was too late for her to get things out of her house trailer.
And this is her house trailer over here, this blue and white.
This blue and white right here? Mm-hmm. Okay. So she had to, this one right here.
Yep.
Now, Denise is an alderman, or an elder of the city.
Mm-hmm.
Look at how deep that truck is there, his mufflers.
He's going off the road a little bit, I think.
Yeah, I think he needs to be over this way.
That right side there.
But you're blowing bubbles with your muffler now.
Let me look how it's doing out here.
Now, where's your church located?
The churches are to our left, a block. They're within a block of each other.
Well, there's just blocks on either side of us here, just running down with houses on all directions here, isn't there?
Anywhere you look, there's houses off their foundations.
The mud is completely...
Yeah, this is a nice house.
Long deer car department.
Uh-oh. Our car just stalled here.
That's where we park.
Water and electricity don't make it.
Man, this is not a house out here.
Yep. Pumping out your basement?
We don't have many basements in this Alexandria. They fill up with water.
Oh, really?
We're now trying to get some water to wash some mud out of the garage.
Oh, you're using some water to wash out the inside of the house? Or?
Yeah.
What is your name, sir?
Walt King.
Walt Caton?
King.
Yeah, you live here?
Yeah, I live all across.
Okay.
Outside the school over there.
You lose your home?
Sure did.
You think it's repairable at all?
It's kind of borderline.
Borderline. Are you planning on moving back into town?
Probably. Everybody said it's going to probably be the biggest frog in the puddle. Here I am.
Okay.
I got a business over here, too. I got a salvage yard.
Salvage yard? And you're in our prayers. We have a minister with us. We're going to represent hundreds of churches.
I see.
And whatever doesn't get done by other people, we're going to try to fill the cracks, not only with finances, but also with manpower. We hope to have thousands of people come into the areas and help. Until it's all done.
Well, that'd be nice.
You bet. So, you're in our prayers. God bless you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. On the other side of the levee.
Okay. So you've been destroyed too?
No, I don't.
Okay. Is the water still in the house?
It shouldn't be.
Is this the first time you've been down here since the flood, or?
Well, we came down earlier. We took some friends down here. They own the video store.
Right.
We brought them down. Look in, we're going to come down Friday and help them move everything out.
Well, what is your name?
Melody and Joe Atterberg.
Atterberg?
Yeah.
Melody and Joe. What's your little girl's name?
Little Sarah.
Sarah. How are you, Sarah? Are you just, you know, I see no tears in your eyes. As long as Mom and Daddy is okay, you'll be okay, won't you? Amen. Amen.
Are you hoping to come back?
Yeah.
You do that muffler?
Maybe, yeah. Depends on how much it's gone.
Yeah, that's right. Okay.
Thank you.
Yep.
Hey, can we go in his house? He said he'd be right out. Yeah, he said we'd go in there.
Oh, well, let's do it.
Give your view to me. Gotta be very careful not to drop the camera in this stuff. It's like walking on an ice rink. Mud. Rocks.
Over here, if you look up at the ceiling, You can see the remnants of a beautiful ceiling fan with a lot of nice fixtures, and of course that was their kitchen. But here, the water was high enough that it got up beyond the first floor. And what did he tell us? Some 20 feet of water in here. And so this house has got a lot of work to be done on it. He's done a lot of work. He's gotten the mud.
Yeah, you can see a nice slate floor for the kitchen. There's carpet in here. All that's outside. Looks like a big mud hole. The furnace got left in here, of course. I'm sure everything did, like the nice fans. You can tell this house was fixed up pretty nice. But after the flood gets through, there's nothing nice about anything that's going on. Right now, it's full of moisture. It's real hot inside here.
It's just like a steam bath.
Right. When laborers come in, if they repair this thing, it's going to take a lot of work, taking down all the walls, putting back insulation, sheetrock. And a crew of 10 men can gut this thing in one day. The next day, have everything back on there, then start finishing up. And of course, it's sitting the same way. I'm not exactly, a carpenter has to look at it, find out what it was and what it can be again. But with your prayers, your support, and there's hundreds of letters going out to different churches right now to get different people, that's churches now. Probably 1,000 churches will have letters given to them, and then they have congregations probably averaging from 40 to 80. So there's thousands of people, and you can be one of them who will call up Brother Cliff Phillips in the future. The name will be on the bottom of the TV screen. Call the Salvation Army, different ones, and say, listen, I'm willing to help, I can do this.
Carl, we're setting up a center at 601 Main.
Okay.
It'll be a temporary headquarters for this coordinated effort.
That's at Vision?
That's at Site Vision Center at 601 Main.
Uh-huh.
Will be a temporary headquarters. There'll be a staff there during the day to coordinate effort for sign up. If you are in some church that isn't apprised of this or hasn't gotten on board yet and you want to work, you can come in there and sign up for work teams. If you've got a pickup, certainly this stuff has to be hauled somewhere.
Right, yeah.
And I see here a lot of lath that's got to come out. And as you say, though, a day's work in here with a crew of men could make a world of difference.
Right.
And I'm sure it'd give this man a great boost.
Yes, I'm sure it will.
This has to be heartbreaking.
Yes. We're going to go down to the churches now and possibly go in, we hope.
Yeah, come over to the church there. Maybe you can walk over there, Cliff, and I'll follow you. Walk down the sidewalk there, or...
Yeah, I'll walk down the road.
Yeah. Look at all that mud inside there.
Inside the church house door.
Yeah.
See?
How deep is that there?
That's about 5 inches deep, I would say.
All through here?
4 or 5.
There's another story to that, too. As the river came up and the water pressure filled the septic tanks, they backed up, pushed everything in them.
From the door to your right.
Back through the sewers.
The sanctuary is off the right here?
Yeah.
Oh, man. It stinks in here too. Yeah, the whole ceiling's falling down and got what, 2-3 inches of mud down here?
Yeah, the ceiling is underneath all this, Jim. I don't know if you get a shot, it's very dark in here. You can see it's a new roof. Inside looks very well constructed and everything. There's mud up on the shelves and along the window sills 2 and 3 inches deep. And so, of course, every house in town is just like this. The church is probably one of the most important, the gathering place of the people. But your home is the nucleus of the church. So it starts right there in home. So what we're after is not to restore buildings, it's to restore homes. And to let them see the love of God. This is what it's all about, is letting people see the love of God. It's people we're interested in. And if we can get them to see the love of God in our hearts, how we are concerned about their home, their families, not the buildings, the families, how we love them, it will cause them to believe in the Son of God. They will know we are Christians by our love, and we have love one to the other. Is that right, preacher?
Amen. That's right.
Amen.
Right on. I noticed the pews and furnishings are out of here, and we're glad to see that they were able to salvage that.
But this is hard to talk because
you're a pastor.
You realize that this is where the church meets. This isn't the church. This isn't the church. This is where the church meets.
Yes.
But it's still near and dear to hearts. And I can well imagine this fairly new building, that there was a lot of blood, sweat, and tears go into this mm-hmm. by the congregation. And they have to be devastated. And we need to reach out to these people any way we can.
Amen.
Let them know we're praying for them.
That would basement?
No. Boy, this pastor's study here is just totally...
Is there a desk in here?
No, it looks like they got the desk and stuff out, but the walls and all the shelves and everything else is just caved in. Yeah, it is hot in here.
Well, you are. We got there. Can we get in the front door, you think? Yeah, might be.
Can you make that, Jim?
Oh, yeah. I don't mind the mud so much, but I hate to get, you know, totally wet if I don't have to.
This is the Presbyterian church. You on?
Yeah.
And there's a retired minister from Canton, or from Keokuk, comes over here to pastor.
Oh. They've been cleaning in here already.
They've done some cleaning already.
A lot of work has already been done here.
Now, we saw the devastation of the Baptist church across the street. This had to look just like that. It had to have four or five inches of mud.
The gentleman said they already hosed out a lot of buildings, and this is one of them. You can tell it's still good red carpet. It'll take a lot of deodorizing. It's coming up over here.
All the flooring is warped, though. You can see that the floor is warped. They would have to have underlayment put on and new carpet, probably.
The ceiling was high enough in this building, though, to where it escaped damage.
In fact, you can see it about two-thirds up the wall over there, the line.
There's a fellowship hall just down the stairways, nice, beautiful, and must have been real modern. And then, of course, offices just upstairs above that floor. And it's a wonderful structure even yet, but it has to be cleaned up and taken care of. Dry rot could set in if it doesn't get air and dry out good. And so this is just one of the things that's happening. It doesn't pick out any one person. The righteous and the unrighteous, the believer and the unbeliever, all in the same one. But pure gold is going to be gold no matter where you put it. The wood, hay, and stubble will dissolve and change and dissipate and go away. But the real love of God will remain. And that's what we're talking about. It's a Presbyterian church. You pastor a community church, a Baptist church across the street. It could be a Catholic church down the way. We all need to love God. And the scripture says if you love God, you can't help but love your fellow man. Mm-hmm. You can't not love your fellow man and love God. You cannot do it. Take a run around town again and maybe go into a couple more buildings and let you see all that's going on. Okay? Praise the Lord.
Well, we're hoping not to get stuck here, huh?
Yep, we are. There's about 6 inches of mud. I mean, pure chocolate icing mud type of thing.
I mean, yeah. It is slick.
If we make one mistake here, we'll...
No, we can drive back to this car.
This house over here.
There's some houses right down to this window, Jim.
Oh, yeah, that's just loaded with houses around here.
You can tell that a couple of those are not sitting right.
There's some folks there. You want to go down and speak to them?
No, you don't. That's muddy down there, Carl. Awful muddy.
Right, see the home there?
Yeah, it's knee-deep mud.
There's a building that's washed up against another building. See that at the end of the road?
Yes.
Can you focus on that?
Yeah, we have a family down here cleaning out. We don't want to go down there. I'll tell you what. You want to go down there?
I don't think it's safe. Look at the mud.
Okay. Then this is what we need to do is come in here now and make phone calls to Salvation Army and say, what can we do? If you have a couple days off or one day a week, let's contact people in Alexandria and the Salvation Army. We'll give you the name pretty soon who you can contact, and you can come down right here and get delivered in here and help them, whatever they have need of. And so let's just keep that in prayer.
Can you imagine what an encouragement it would be to those people? Now look, there's children down there helping. What an encouragement it would be if five or six people pulled up and said, we want to help.
Boys, I'm going to drive down there. I feel under conviction already.
You don't have to preach very long, Brother Phillips.
I mean, you Carl, that's awful thick mud down there on that road. You know how you slipped back here.
Yeah, I see that.
We warned him, Jim.
Yeah, you see a four-wheel drive truck down there, but we'll find out. We'll walk out and try to get some mud.
I wanted to visit with you a little bit because I'm Pastor Cliff Phillips of Basin Avenue Community Church, and I represent some 20-25 churches that are coming together in the Quincy area to coordinate health. That's hands-on, sleeves rolled up, walk in the mud help. And could you use some of that?
Well, honey, I tell you what, you look at this and we have decided what have we got to say. You know, we came down with, I was down here first with my nephew. My house is off the foundation. And as you go in there and look, honey, and look and see what is there to save.
Jim, take a picture of this in here.
It's what is there to save. You know, I did find four little pieces here.
How long was this your home?
Oh, Lord, 29
years. Wait till you get on the microphone.
Yeah.
So this is home
from right here.
This was home for 29 years. That's almost a lifetime, isn't it?
It's a lifetime. I've lived down here since 1947.
Well, what is your name now?
Virginia Alvis.
Virginia Alvis?
Uh-huh.
Been here 29 years?
I've been in this home 29 years.
And they just called you grandma a while ago, right?
Yes. This is my daughter-in-law, and these are all my grandchildren.
Let's have some names here.
This is my daughter-in-law, Renee.
Okay.
And this is Lacey Jane Dakota.
Okay.
And this is Destiny.
Destiny?
Destiny.
Very good.
And that's Randy.
He's a hard-working one guy over here.
And that's Jerry.
Yeah,
that's my grandson, okay. Jerry.
I'm Randy.
That's Randy and Jerry. Okay. Virginia, if you had help that moved out this stuff you see loose and helped take the plaster off so that a ceiling could be hung in there and sheetrock put in it, and that could happen, that could happen in 3 or 4 days' time. Would that help the load a little?
Well, it would, but my house is totally
off the foundation.
It is. It's off the foundation.
You're off the foundation, aren't you?
So,
So what are you thinking about doing then?
Bulldozing it down.
I mean, and building back again?
I don't know. I'm 61 years old. Where do you go? My whole life.
You've been here half your life. They're 29 years.
Yeah. Yes. But, honey, my whole life, like I said, my husband been dead 8 years. My whole house is paid for. I mean, lock, stock, and barrel. Every penny I've ever had has gone into this house. Over, you know, I worked at Montgomery Ward's when I was, while they closed down.
And yet it's not covered by any insurance.
No, sir, I have no insurance. So where do I go? You know, we'll be 61, 29th of September.
What is across the street here?
That was Larry Fojic's trailer.
And the neighbors.
And is that a house?
Geraldine Wilson.
Or a shed?
That was a shed.
That was a shed.
Over here was Vera Smoot, that garage.
How old is Vera? Is she?
Oh, she's probably 65.
Okay,
she's retired. Almost everybody's retired. This old gentleman over here is close to 80. This over here. Now, her son, Larry, is, I don't know, maybe 45. This lady here is retired. She's renting a place in Cahokia. Almost everyone around here is older.
What do you think the feeling is, Virginia? Are most of them saying it's too much, we can't come back, or what?
Right now it's running. Like, when I first seen this, I was okay for about 4 hours, and I went home and I cried and I cried and I cried and I screamed, I'm not ever coming back, I'm not coming back, I'm not coming back. And that's the way with a lot of them. I mean, at first they say, we're not going back. And then as you stop and think, what have we got? You know, where are we going to go?
Because this was home and it was paid for.
This is home and it was paid for. If you want to see the rest of the house.
Sure, can you show me the kitchen in there?
Sure.
Jim, we're going to let you do that.
Okay. Boy, it looks like a war zone in here.
It's like I said, you think you know what you're going to have, but until you get in here, you don't.
Now, you got someone taking pictures back here? It's just unbelievable.
Okay, Randy, get back home.
No, that's all right. You can see, it looks good.
These are my cabinets.
Yeah, that's fine.
These are fairly new cabinets. I had a nice house. I really had a nice house.
Yeah, it looks like it was nice here.
I got pictures
This is like the dining room area?
This is the dining room.
You can have pictures?
I had, they're in my car at Whalen. I had before pictures. My backyard, the grass, a green velvet carpet. I mean, I had grass, I had flowers.
Very good. Sir, what is your name?
My name's Randy Alvis. I'm her son. The only son.
Very good.
The only child.
This is your mother and this is your children, right?
Uh-huh. Yeah, these are my wife and children.
You met them a while ago.
Right. I grew up in this house. But well, the way I see it is it's more like when the flood hit, it would be like somebody getting a cancer. Okay? All right. And now is more like waiting for it to die. Because you ask if people are ready to come back, you know, people want to know, are you coming back? Well, you don't know. They're not dead yet. You know, I mean, the house is off the foundation. It's like having a cancer and waiting to die.
Right.
The way I see it.
And just waiting to see what happens.
Right.
It may get cured, it may not.
Right.
Okay, but if we all pull together, if everybody works, if you see 500 people come in here, 1,000 people in Alexandria with material and work and hard labor, there's nothing that we can't accomplish if you really work hard at it.
Well,
that's the miracle.
That's true.
Greatest miracle in the Bible when God had 120 people in one mind and one accord.
Right.
That was a big miracle.
That's true. However, it takes a lot more to mend the spirit of these people that's been broken. I mean, because like I said, she's owned this house 30 years.
Gregory Street right here. Gregory Avenue.
This is uptown. This is uptown Alexandria.
Yes. These houses were in all good shape. It's livable and it was home to a lot of people. We're going to drive up to the railroad track here and get a peek in some of these houses. So,
Carl, we're getting lost up here. We'd get in trouble quickly. We got to make a right-hand turn up with this intersection.
Yeah, you might want to get some speed up here.
We're going to get that drive.
Right here. Yeah, this is it.
Down by the church.
Did you say my speed, ready?
Mm-hmm.
Front wheel.
Drive down that one street that we drove down a while ago that we didn't take pictures of, and it would just break your heart. We're about run out of a battery here.
Yeah, we're at 50% now.
Half of it's gone already. Yeah. We've been through one already. We just got started. So we're going to talk to the Salvation Army Major in just a moment, and we'll let you know just exactly what plan for Alexandria as far as the Salvation Army is concerned. If we get out of this water, it's pretty deep right now.
Looks to me like this is up since we came in.
Yeah, what were you saying now, Cliff?
I say it looks like the water is up since we came in, and it could be that foot raise that's on the way down is getting here.
Yeah, six-inch of rain up north just 24 hours ago.
So that shows how you could get back in there and have to get a boat out.
Slow. these homes through here are just completely devastated. The major cleanup job here, I imagine, is just going to be loading these in trucks and hauling off the rubble. Of course, there's a lot of mud, as you can see, even on the road here. Looks like this road's been scraped off. Got a house over here that pretty much well gutted, shifted on its foundation. Easy, Carl. Pulling off the road here for someone. A lot of mud here. All this water. Truck's underwater over there. I'm just going to go out the side.
Major Eames from Keokuk, Salvation Army. Been with the Salvation Army many years and involved in other disasters, tornadoes and such like. But Major, how would you compare this to other disasters you've been involved with?
Well, it certainly is the worst that I've ever seen, and as a long-term recovery outlook, I think it's the worst
to go.
Flood since Noah. Yeah
since Noah. When did the Army become involved over here in the Alexandria disaster?
Right as soon as they started sandbagging.
Which was a couple of weeks before the levee broke?
Right, eight days.
And how were you helping then?
Well, we were providing cold drinks and food and meals, the food for meals that were being served in the fire department here in LA.
And then after the levee broke and the floodwaters came in, they set up a disaster center over at Wayland?
Yes, they did, in the fire department there.
And did you help out over there?
Yes, we provided most of the food, or a lot of the food, and other things like eyeglasses, and people came that needed prescriptions and things like that, a lot of things that you wouldn't think of, but the flood hit so quickly and so many people didn't get things out that...
So they even left glasses behind.
Right, yeah.
And so how many people did you feed over there at the firehouse?
Well, I think they started out with well over 100.
Well over 100, and it tapered down.
And as you know, there's a support base here. People have family.
So you served actually several thousand meals, didn't you?
Yeah.
And you're not finished yet?
No, we're here on location now as people come in to clean up, and as churches and groups come to volunteer. And as you can see, it's hot, and so there's a need to provide cold drinks and things like that.
Major, you and I have talked about what we're endeavoring to put together, a coordinated effort by several churches to coordinate some help. We've had people from away from the area offer to come and help. Is there a need, as you see it, is there still a great need for that kind of service?
Yes, it's this is Christian service at its best, and denominational barriers aside, there's room for everyone who would lift up the name of Jesus and you know, get involved here.
So are we pretty well getting to the end of this, or are we just getting to the beginning?
Well, we're through the we hope we're through the flood stage, and now we're in the second stage, which is the cleanup and restoration, and just to see what can be saved, and we'll begin with the community buildings and churches and community buildings first.
Okay. If we got in touch with you as a group of ministers, would you help us be pointed in the right direction?
I certainly would.
God bless.
I appreciate all the Christian people have done and continue to do in the name of Christ.
Okay, we're going from Alexander. We're driving over to Meyer right now. We've got this thunderstorm we have to contend with. But the pictures you just saw a while ago, the rain is right there also. So there's a lot to contend with. The people need your prayer. There's always a plan of God behind all this that goes on. We're going to take you into Meyer right now, even though it's raining hard, and give you a peek at what's going on at the present time. We're shooting this August the 11th on a Wednesday. And it's really coming down hard right now.
That water in the gutters already.
It's just washing right up the road and it's raining.
Spans this valley, we're standing on the middle of the road that goes to Meyer. We thought we were going to go to Meyer and take some pictures, but it's going to be a while. This is some idea of the awesomeness of this flood. The water's down several feet, as you know, but there it is right here west of Lima, about 3 miles we come to this, and Meyer is somewhere off in the distance, but it's going to be a while before there's any cleanup done down there. It's going to be a while before we know how much damage is done, whether there's anything to clean up or not. So this shortened our trip. We'll be going to Hull, and there we'll be able to see some of the damage in Hull. Hopefully we've got more hope in Hull for recovery of some nice homes and such like down there. The water hasn't been in Hull as long as what we looked at up at Alexandria. But this water's been in here for quite some time, and this of course is the Indian Grave levee break, the North Indian Grave, and merged with Lima Lake, and so at some points along here this river gets to be exceedingly wide.
Oh, you didn't see that?
No, not earlier. Well, I was looking at the big perspective.
The water was clear up here into this corn, so.
Yeah, this corn is still, well, it's no good.
That's a great spot right there.
Right there.
Yeah.
Water just coming nuts in the rain.
Now they got some more equipment over here. I wonder if that was salvaged.
Yes, that would have been brought up here out before the flood to preserve it.
Hull, Illinois now. The water has already left the city. We'll give you a shot of that. Just outside the city limits, just outside of town. You can see where the water has been. It's been about 3 foot high in this area right here. Wouldn't you say that?
Actually, it's been quite a bit higher. You can notice the levels on the house. Probably in the house, it was 4 feet deep. And so right in this area, I would put it at maybe 8 foot deep.
Okay, now this is Cameron Colgrove and his wife Allison. And glad to meet you. You live in Quincy, don't you?
Yes, we do.
And your mother and father lives here?
That's correct.
What's their name?
Robert and Betty Colgrove.
Okay. What's the address right here, this street?
This is Walnut Street. And actually, there aren't any numbers assigned to the town. Okay. They didn't even have the names of the street.
It's right across the street from the Methodist Church.
That's correct.
Catty Corner.
Yeah.
And the Methodist Church did a great thing for the neighbors a while ago. What happened?
They sure did. Well, they all got together, the MCOR, and they came in and they volunteered to clean up any house in town, and they're going to stay with it until the cleaning is done. Now, the ones we had that came in yesterday were from about 40 miles from the Indiana line here in Illinois, and they just loaded up, came over, and they came in and started to work. And we'd been doing this for a couple of days, and it just seemed overwhelming. It seemed like a war zone in there, like things you just can't imagine.
Was the walls falling off? And
Our walls were a little lucky because they were plaster. They weren't insulated. This house was built in the 40s. So it didn't take as much damage on the walls.
And it's pretty high up, too. You step up and
It's up, but still, it was chest high in there. But the floors are going to have to be taken up, and everything that was in there has to come out. Right. Nothing is reusable again because of the contamination from the water. But this crew came in, and just in one day, it made it hopeful again. Because they got to work, and I mean, with smiles on their faces, they kept at it, and they cleaned, and they did things that would have taken us a week or two to do. Without them, we would still be so far back.
How many was in the crew that came?
I think there was
five altogether. And then one of the men got on the phone and called all of the churches within a certain radius trying to recruit more volunteers, because when he saw all the work that needed to be done here and all the people that need help here.
They have neighbors that are kind of elderly, right?
Oh,
there's
yes.
lots of people in the neighborhood that need help that just can't get in to do the work.
And some have jobs and they can't afford to take it off because they're just living right on their means.
And it's important that the work gets started soon, because the mildew and everything else gets working on the wood and everything. It's important that the work and the rugs get pulled up and everything gets aired out and the windows get open, and so there's a lot of people that need help.
Okay.
That's why the Methodist Corps was so great, and they had to go home last night all the way back there after they'd got done with the full day of work, and then they're coming back this Saturday, and they're going to start in again.
Okay, so you suggested any church organization that wanted to, how would they get a hold of these people here? Just come to town?
Come to town. There's a checkpoint right as you're coming into town.
Yes, we
And they can
that.
Stop and talk to the people there, and there's people signed up that need help, and they could just come into town for that matter, and anyone that's in their house needs help right now, believe me.
That's
they
great.
Can contact the local churches also, and I know it would be hard to get in touch with people. Everyone's displaced, but they might be able to direct it to certain families that
really
need help.
We'll get some phone numbers here in just a moment or two when we leave town
where
they can call and get in there. Can we take a look at your house inside?
Sure thing. Okay. Come right on in. You don't have to worry about wiping your feet.
All this has been thrown out now.
Everything, see, the first reports told us that the water would be no higher than 3 feet in hull. So we believed it, and we put things up on sawhorses or raised it, you know, to a higher elevation. But of course, the water came in and just swept everything.
It was 2 foot higher than that one. Four foot higher.
Yes, exactly. It went so much higher. Now watch your step on these floorboards, because where they're swelled and pushed up, it's hard to walk through here. Sometimes we've taken the doors off and just trying to take everything salvageable that we can keep in here to clean. But most of it that's left in is just no good anymore. This is a kitchen. This was tile floor. And
there was tile on the floor?
Yes, there was.
Okay.
And it just came up with a sweep of your feet. It was too bad. You know, we still have water in the drawers that we haven't got cleaned out yet. Of course, the bugs and mosquitoes are just terrible.
Right. I see you have a wick here to take the smell out.
Yes, exactly.
That's good.
And hold it up a little bit.
Yeah.
Now, the water was approximately this high at its highest point in here.
Okay.
And we still have water in the basement. It has to be pumped out slowly, maybe only a foot a day, to help equalize the pressure. Otherwise, it can cause the walls
to
collapse.
The water will cave it in.
Yes.
But the water pressure on the outside.
Exactly. It's just too great. Now that it's receding a little bit, we can get started on that. But again, it's a foot a day procedure. When they showed up, still had the bed frames and one box springs we put up that hadn't got out. These things were all tipped over, dressers fallen over, and just turned to paper. There's nothing left in them at all. And practically had to take it out with scoop shovels.
Right.
But this room looked like it could never be lived in again.
Now, your mother and father, which is Robert and Betty Colgrove,
right.
Their mother fell and broke their hip.
Yes.
They have to go to the hospital and take care of her and be with her.
Yes. She had to be operated on with her leg, and she's 92 years old, so very infirm. So they haven't been able to get back in here to do hardly anything. They stopped in yesterday once on going up to the hospital, and Mom had never seen it since the flood, and it really hit her heart. But, you know, once she saw that it was starting the operation, we had all that good help here to do it.
This looks like a good job done.
Yes.
Especially after you've been to Alexandria.
Yeah.
So we're going to look at some other your neighbor's houses here in District 1. Sure.
Here we are driving down Hull Street here, Walnut Street and Cherry Street in Hull. And it appears now is the time to come to Hull and help clean up. Yeah. They say you can come into town, and if you get some people with your church, this would be great. This would be the perfect time to do it. Of course, this is Thursday, August 12th today, but I imagine this for several weeks they're going to be cleaning. The smell is pretty bad here. That's one thing the camera don't portray, is how bad it's gonna smell around here, because the water is just stagnant. As you can see, people are dragging stuff out of their homes, and all these houses here, a lot different from Alexandria where we were at. All of these look like they're going to be, well, there's people living in them right now. They're working to get them cleaned up. All this was underwater here, this whole area.
Okay, we're going north on Elm Street right here. I hope you can read the name of this church. It's Nazarene Church here in Hull, the Church of the Nazarene. And I'm sure there's lots of work needs to be done in there, but I'm sure the congregation, of course, will do that. But there are many people here, especially elderly people, who do not have anyone to help them. Maybe their children are far away, but there are hundreds of residences that need your help. And today is a day to begin to think, what am I going to do this weekend? You may gather at church somewhere, but you need to maybe put your overalls on after church, and maybe the pastor and the Sunday school class can come out and take care of one of these houses. There's 400 churches in the WTJR viewing area, it reaches out about 100 miles each direction. And if every church would just do one house in their community up and down this river, I'm sure we could get a lot of things done. The Salvation Army is doing a great job. On both sides of this street, there are homes that are real good homes. Alexandria was a disaster, the whole town. The levee was right next to the town. It was an older town also, right on the river. This is a little newer town. The homes, most of them are not quite as old. And that was devastated. I mean, about 90% of the houses were off the foundation or destroyed altogether. Here, I haven't seen one that is not repairable and in pretty good shape on the outside, but inside, everything has to come off, especially the plasterboard, the insulation in the walls. Draws the moisture up inside the walls, even into the ceiling, and it's collapsed and fell off. We'd take you in every one of these, but it's not necessary to do that. One or two, this beautiful brick home right behind us, even you can see how high the water was. Everything in there has to be taken care of. And I'm sure that there's a lot of people working now saying, I want to do something, but today is the day, okay? Now's the time to call. We're going to go to the Salvation Army post. As you just turn to come into Hull, you have a register that you can register, and they'll put your name down and tell you where you're needed, where you can work together with a few people, or four or five people on one project. If you work together, it's a lot easier. I'm sure there's tractors and dumpsters and the dump stuff in there, but there's work for everyone. You can rake the yard. The children can rake the yard inside. Just be careful with nails sticking up and whatever. But there's a place for you. And this is quite a devastated area. The school needs cleaned out, of course. But there's room for everyone in this community, in West Quincy, in Alexandria, in LaGrange area, up and down the Indian Graves place where what's the name of that town up there?
Alexandria.
No, we tried to get there yesterday and couldn't
Meyer.
Get there. Meyer, yes, Meyer. There's many places, but you can call WTJR and we will try to give you the number, or 1440. They did a great job. 1440 on your radio dial, AM radio. Call them in the mornings, and they will give you other numbers also. but Clifford Phillips is setting up a great group of ministers that are trying to get hundreds and hundreds of churches together, denominations, to send in people from different churches. And this is what we're trying to do with WTJR, is get people involved in it. You need to be involved. If you can get someone to babysit the children, maybe you can come down and do some cleaning, okay? Maybe there'll be a babysitting place set up. I think the Salvation Army has that. They did have it during the sandbagging. So maybe they have that too. We'll ask them right down the road. So they're right outside of town and just east of Hull.
Carl Gesendorfer with WTJR. Good to meet you.
How's he doing?
I'm fine. Sure. John Pinnick.
Hey, John. Good to meet you.
There's the sheriff.
There's the sheriff.
You can talk to him.
Sheriff, I'm Carl Gesendorfer. I'm Mike Lord.
I know Carl Gesendorfer.
Very good. How you doing? You got quite a job here, don't you?
Oh, yeah.
We just got to take a little tour of the town. And your job, of course, I guess, to make sure people don't come in and it's not supposed to be there. But if you get a crew of people to come in that will want to clean, the register here with the Salvation Army?
He's asking to leave.
Okay.
Numbers.
Okay.
Why we're here.
Yeah.
We're just here because we love the Lord and we want to help people. And Amen. The Lord has done so much to us, we want to share it with other people.
Yeah, and where are you from, Anna?
I'm from Richmond, Kentucky.
Richmond, Kentucky.
Eighth Street Baptist Association, a little church named Bethlehem.
How big is your church?
I mean, about 60 in it.
That car is going by here. How many is in your church?
We have a membership of about 60.
About 60 in their church, and yet you find people to bring up here, including yourself.
Oh, well, we have a whole association.
Yes, I know it is. Yes. That one church, we're working together.
Southern Baptist. We, all of us are working together. We're from all over Kentucky.
Okay, and this is Francis.
This
is that Leathers?
Leathers.
Leathers? That, and where are you from?
Bardstown, Kentucky.
Bardstown, Kentucky. Thank you for coming to our community to help us out.
You're welcome.
Praise. Now, what is your job right here? What are you doing?
We're giving care kits and giving out cleaning supplies and care kits and the gospel.
For those who would come into Hull from this
anybody
route,
that needs,
just come in and ask for it and you'll give it to them.
Yeah, right. Whatever.
There's soap and mops and buckets even. You have buckets?
Anything we give, try to give love.
And praise the Lord. Well, they're given, they said love is the first ingredient they give. Of course, Jesus Christ is the author of and finisher of love, our faith. And these ladies said they want to give them Bibles and tracts. Do you have some tracts and Bibles?
Yes, sir, we do.
Do you have one handy? I can show the people.
Oh.
Here's some stuff here too, Carl.
Okay.
See it right now.
Yeah, here's a Bible down here. This is a Gideon Bible that they give away. Is that right?
Yes, sir.
That's great.
That's Gideon.
Uh-huh. And this is another one. Here's Hope, the New Testament, King James Version. Mm-hmm. That's one of the best things. Of course, we have soap, all kinds of personal items.
Yep.
Huggies for the diapers. Here's your gospel tract here. The Way of Salvation, Acts 16, 17. Do you want to be saved? If so, here's what to do. So if you want one of these, you just come down here to Hull and they give you one, okay? Praise the Lord. Francis, God bless your heart.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for coming to our
check with our leader down there.
What are we looking at through here, Carl?
This is between Hull and Quincy, Illinois, off of Highway 57. You can see this cornfield right next to the road here. The water's right next to this bank. It's gone down, I would say, about 5 to 6 feet so far, maybe more than that. But it was really devastating to the towns. I don't know how big Hull was, but probably 600. And a lot of homes, beautiful little homes there, a lot of elderly people, senior citizens, and they need help today. They need help now. They have to open the house up, let it air, haul all that stuff out and throw it in the front yard so the city can pick it up, put it in dumpsters, and they need your help. You know, you've got a nice house now that's high and dry, but we need to begin to be active in the body of Christ. I would suggest even some canceling their Sunday morning service and Sunday night service and have prayer around someone's house and show them this is what real church, having church is about, is to visit the widow and the orphans in their time of need. Many widows, especially the senior citizens, their husband's been dead for many years, and they need help today. So now in their affliction, James says to perfect religion undefiled before God and the Father is this, to keep yourself unspotted from the world. And of course, before that, he says to visit the widow and the orphan in their affliction. Right now, these widows and orphans are afflicted, and they do need your help. It's better to go help them now than Sunday morning. Now, that's not outside of Scripture. That is real. But you can have church right there. Hold hands and pray. You can take communion right there. When you're cleaning out a person's house, you can gather out in the front yard, and you can pass communion around. If you take it Sunday morning, you can hug your neighbor, praise God, and really be what God wants us to be. A body that's functioning here on this earth. His body with His mind. So the Scripture commands us to do exactly that. To love one another as He has loved us. Praise God. So I would advise you, please, please, listen to the Spirit of God. And Sunday afternoon, I say tell day Saturday, I want to do something somewhere. Whether on TV camera here or else get out there and help. And we're going to be helping also. If you'd like to get a hold of us some way, I'll tell you where we're going to be. We might be right here in Hull helping some, one of these little widows out. So just pray about that. Get a hold of the Salvation Army. Get a hold of Brother Cliff Phillips. He's got a plan on what's going to be going on also. But we need help today. The people need help today, okay? Praise the Lord.